The empire of the dollar is drawing in its painful agony of death, and its patriarchs are in the state of negation of reality otherwise known as the Trump presidency. Whether or not you want you like to hear it, this is a fact, the greenback is losing out its popularity. This could be very bad for the value of the US dollar in the years to come. You know, central banks throughout the world hold a lot of American dollars. Lately, however, they have been reducing their exposure to the US dollar. If you hold US dollars and dollar-denominated assets, you need to pay close attention to this phenomenon. It could have devastating consequences. The global trade is primarily done in US dollars. How will companies hedge their businesses from a falling dollar? Major commodities are also priced in American dollars. How will producers and end users be impacted? If the value of the American dollar drops, it will have a gigantic effect in all spheres. Actually, the dollar has been slowly collapsing for many years. Better questions are, is the collapse speeding up, and where might the collapse end? Could the buck in your pocket ever become as worthless as the Zimbabwe dollar? Welcome to the Atlantis Report. As long as the global reserve currency is dollar peg on air, it is guaranteed that the purchasing power of all currencies, including the US dollar, will continue to devalue since the gold standard was pulled. You need $635 to match the value of a 1971 $100 bill. The foreign leaders understand the disadvantage of the system against their economy. The dollar has been designed to control everyone's currency and not a very simple system to undo. However, its greed won't last forever. The International Monetary System of Bretton Woods of 1944, as it evolved in the present, has become, honestly said, the biggest obstacle to peace and prosperity in the world. China is increasingly supported by Russia, and the two largest Eurasian nations are taking decisive steps to create a very viable alternative to the tyranny of the US dollar in world trade and finance. Wall Street and Washington are not happy with it, but they are powerless to stop this change. Shortly before the end of World War II, the United States government, influenced by major international Wall Street banks, instituted what many mistakenly believed to be a new gold standard. In truth, it was a dollar standard in which every other currency of the IMF countries had the value hooked on the dollar. In turn, the US dollar was then tied to gold with a value equal to 1/35th of an ounce of gold. At the time, Washington and Wall Street were able to impose such a system because the Federal Reserve held about 75% of all world monetary gold as a result of the war and related developments. Bretton Woods crowned the dollar, which has since become the reserve currency of world trade held by central banks. In the late 1960s, with the growing US budget deficits caused by the costs of the Vietnam War and another insane spending, the dollar standard began to show its profound structural flaws. Once Western Europe and Japan recovered from the war, they no longer needed billions of US dollars to finance the reconstruction. Germany and Japan had become world-class export economies, with greater efficiency in industrial production than in the United States due to the growing obsolescence of the US-based industry, from steel to cars and basic infrastructures. Washington would, therefore, have had to significantly devalue the dollar against gold to correct the growing imbalance in world trade. Such a devaluation of the dollar would have increased the export profits of US production and reduced trade imbalances. It would have been a huge advantage for the real US economy. However, Wall Street banks would have had massive losses. Instead, the US administrations, first Johnson and then Nixon, printed many more dollars by effectively exporting inflation worldwide. Central banks, especially those in France and Germany, reacted to Washington's deafness by demanding their gold back from the United States Federal Reserve in exchange for their US dollar reserves at a price of $35 an ounce, the value set by the Bretton Agreement. Woods of 1944. In August 1971, the redemption of this gold for inflated dollars had reached such a crisis that Nixon, advised by a senior Treasury official, Paul Volcker, decided to tear up the Bretton Woods Agreement. Since 1973, gold was allowed to trade freely by Washington and was no longer the guarantee of a healthy US dollar. Instead, the oil shock in October 1973 raised the price of oil in dollars by 400% in a few months, thus giving birth to what Henry Kissinger then called a petrodollar. The world needed oil for the economy. Washington, in its 1975 deal with the Saudi monarchy, ensured that Arab OPEC would refuse to sell even a drop of its oil in the world for any currency other than the US dollar. The value of the dollar rose against other currencies, such as the German mark or the Japanese yen. The banks of Wall Street were inundated with petrodollar deposits. The dollar casino was open and running, while the rest of the world was being plucked. New York's major international banks such as Chase, Citibank, and Bank of America used petrodollars to launder the profits of Arab oil to oil-importing countries in the developing world during the 1970s, sowing seeds for the so-called Third World Debt Crisis. Curiously, it was Paul Volcker himself, a protege of David Rockefeller and the Rockefellers' Chase Manhattan Bank, who this time, in October 1979, as president of the Federal Reserve, triggered the debt crisis of the 1980s by pushing interest rates of the Fed until it breaks through the roof. He lied and said it was necessary to freeze inflation. All this to save the dollar and the Wall Street banks. Today, the dollar is a strange phenomenon, to put it mildly. The United States, since 1971, has gone from being a large industrial nation to a gigantic speculative casino swollen with debt. With federal fund interest rates between 0% and 1% in the past 9 years, which is unprecedented in modern history, the major Wall Street banks, whose financial counterfeiting and murderous greed have created the crisis of subprime in 2007 and the subsequent global financial tsunami of 2008, are committed to creating a new speculative bubble. Rather than lend money to cities in debt for the construction of urgently needed infrastructure or to other productive roots of the real economy, they created another colossal bubble in the stock market instead. Large corporations used low-cost credit to buy back their stocks, thus pushing stock prices in Wall Street markets, an increase fueled by hype and myths about economic recovery. The S&P 500 share index increased by 320% compared to the end of 2008. I can assure you with certainty that this growth of shares did not occur because the real U.S. economy grew by 320%. For decades, American families have been making less and less in real terms every year. Average household incomes have stagnated since 1988, with inflation rising steadily, real income declines. They must borrow more than ever before. The debt of the federal government has reached an unsustainable value of $20 trillion, 20,000 billion, without being able to see the end. The American industry has been closed, and production has been shipped abroad, outsourced, is the euphemism used. Left behind is an indebted and rotten service economy, in which millions of people have two or even three part-time jobs just to keep themselves afloat. The only factor that helps keep the dollar out of a total collapse is the U.S. military and Washington's deployment of fraudulent NGOs around the world to facilitate the looting of the world economy. As long as Washington's dirty tricks and Wall Street machinations managed to create crises as they did in the Eurozone in 2010 by hitting Greece, those countries with world trade surpluses such as China, Japan, and then Russia had no practical alternative to buying U.S. government debt securities, treasury bonds, with most of the dollars of their trade surplus. Washington and Wall Street were so laughing. They could print endless volumes of dollars backed by nothing more than the F-16s and Abrams tanks. China, Russia, and the other dollar bondholders, by purchasing U.S. debt, actually financed the U.S. wars directed against them. At that time, they had few viable alternative options. Viable alternatives emerged. Now, ironically, two of the foreign economies that have allowed the dollar an artificial extension of their lives beyond 1989, Russia and China, are carefully revealing the most feared of alternatives, an international currency guaranteed by gold and, potentially, numerous similar currencies that can eliminate the unfair hegemonic role of the dollar. For many years, both the Russian Federation and the People's Republic of China have purchased large quantities of gold, largely to add it to their currency reserves in central banks, which otherwise would typically be in dollars or euros. Until recently, it was not clear why. For many years in the gold markets, it was known that the major buyers of physical gold were the central banks of China and Russia. What was not so clear was how deep their strategy was beyond simply creating confidence in their currencies amid the growing economic sanctions and warlike proclamations of the trade war that came from Washington. It is now clear why. China and Russia, probably with their main trading partner countries in BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, as well as their Eurasian partner countries of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, SCO, are about to complete the architecture of the creation of a new monetary alternative to that of the dollar world. Currently, in addition to the founding members of China and Russia, full members of the SCO include Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, and, more recently, India and Pakistan. It is a population of no less than 3 billion people, about 42% of the entire world population, gathered in a coherent, planned, peaceful economic and political cooperation. If we add the official observer states, Afghanistan, Belarus, Iran, and Mongolia, which have expressed the desire to formally join as effective members, to the member countries of the SCO, a look at the world map will show the impressive potential of the emerging countries of the SCO. Turkey is a formal dialogue partner that explores any application for admission to the SCO, as well as Sri Lanka, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Cambodia, and Nepal. This scenario, in a nutshell, is simply enormous. The BRI is a Silk Road supported by gold. Until recently, expert groups in Washington and the government have despised emerging Eurasian institutions such as the SCO. Unlike the BRICS, which are not contiguous countries in the vast mass of the terrestrial globe, those of the SCO form a geographical entity called Eurasia. When Chinese President Xi Jinping proposed creating what was later called the New Economic Silk Road at a meeting in Kazakhstan in 2013, few in the West took it seriously. Today's official name is the Belt and Road Initiative, BRI. Today, the world is beginning to take the purpose of the BIS seriously. It is clear that China's economic diplomacy, like those of Russia and its group of countries of the Eurasian Economic Union, is strongly focused on the creation of advanced high-speed railways, ports, energy infrastructures that weave a new vast market capable, within less than a decade at the current rate, to obscure any economic potential of the OECD, North American and European countries, economically stagnant and inflated by debt. What was hitherto extremely necessary, but not yet clear, was a strategy to free the nations of Eurasia from the dollar and their vulnerability to further US Treasury sanctions and financial warfare based on their dependence on the dollar. Now, this is about to happen. At the annual BRICS summit on September 5 in Xiamen, China, Russian President Putin presented the Russian vision of the current economic world simply and clearly. He said, Russia shares the concerns of the BRICS countries about the injustice of the world's financial and economic architecture, which does not take into account the growing weight of emerging economies. We are ready to collaborate with our partners to promote reforms to the international financial regulation and to overcome the excessive domination of a limited number of reserve currencies. As far as I know, it has never been so explicit on the issue of currencies. Put this in the context of the latest financial architecture unveiled by Beijing, and it will become clear to you that the world is about to enjoy new degrees of economic freedom. Forward contracts on oil in Chinese yuan. According to a report by Japan Nikkei Asian Review, China is about to start a futures contract for crude oil denominated in Chinese yuan, which will be redeemable for gold. Together with other moves from China in the past 2 years to make Shanghai a viable alternative to London and New York, this will make things really interesting. China is the world's largest oil importer, most of which is still paid in US dollars. If the new oil futures denominated in yuan acquire broad acceptance, they could become the most important Asian reference for crude oil, given that China is the largest oil importer in the world. This would challenge the two oil contracts dominated by Wall Street, the Brent oil futures of the North Sea, and that of West Texas, which have so far given Wall Street immense hidden advantages. This would be a huge manipulation lever eliminated by China and its oil partners, including Russia, in particular. The yuan recently acquired membership in the SDR, the selected group of currencies of the International Monetary Fund, and the introduction of an oil futures contract traded in Shanghai in this currency could, especially if convertible into gold, dramatically shift the balance geopolitics of power from the Atlantic world to Eurasia. In April 2016, China made the big move to become the new center for the exchange of gold and the world center for trade in gold, physical gold. China is now the largest gold producer in the world, far ahead of South Africa, also a member of the BRICS, with Russia in second place. China has now set up a large storage center in the free trade area in Qianhai, near Shenzhen, the city of about 18 million inhabitants immediately north of Hong Kong on the Pearl River Delta. China is completing the construction of a permanent structure dedicated to gold, with a connected warehouse, a trading square, and related offices. The Chinese Gold and Silver Exchange Society of Hong Kong, founded 105 years ago, is in a joint project with ICBC, China's largest state bank and its largest gold import bank, to create the Qianhai Storage Center. It is starting to become clear why Washington's fraudulent NGOs like the National Endowment for Democracy attempted, unsuccessfully, to create an anti-Beijing colored revolution, the Umbrella Revolution, in Hong Kong in late 2014. Now, the addition of the new oil futures contract exchanged in China in yuan and convertible into gold, will lead to a dramatic shift of the main members of OPEC, even in the Middle East, towards the preference of guaranteed yuan in gold for their oil instead of US dollars, inflated and subject to geopolitical risks as Qatar experienced after Trump's visit to Riyadh. In particular, the Russian state-owned oil giant Rosneft has just announced that the Chinese state-owned oil company, CEFC China Energy Company Limited, has just purchased a 14% stake in Rosneft from Qatar. Everything begins to emerge as a very coherent strategy. The dollar empire is dragging on in its painful death agony, and its patriarchs are in a state of denial of reality, otherwise known as the Trump presidency. In the meantime, the healthy elements of this world are trying to build constructive and peaceful alternatives. They are even open to letting Washington join them under honest rules. It is extraordinarily generous, isn't it? By helping to maintain the strength of the US dollar, Russia and China are actually assisted themselves and their allies in getting more bang for their American bucks while they replaced their dollar reserves with gold. This can't bode anything good for America, its currency, and the countries that see the dollar as maintaining its strength. However, the countries who are following the lead of Russia and China on the BNR, whom Orwell called East Asia and Eurasia, will refuse to accept the US dollar for their exports in the trade from the countries comprising Oceania and will demand payment for them with gold or in the currency they use. One day soon, what's left of America's economic strength will derive from the barrel of their guns, the threat of sabotage by the CIA, and from the U.S. self-endorsed right to print as much currency as its Fed deems necessary. This was the Atlantis Report. Please like, share, and subscribe. Thank you.